Hello. Let's talk about composition in Tidal. It's a bit of an interesting topic because it means two different things. In music, it means making a piece, I suppose, composing. But in computer programming, composition is about sticking functions together to make new functions. So these are two different meanings, but they kind of relate to each other when it comes to live coding because you're doing both, especially with something like Tidal, which is based on a functional programming language, which is all about functional composition. The aim of this is, of course, making music, but along the way, we'll also talk about functional composition because that's what Tidal music is all about. Let's have a look at the worksheet. So, here is a familiar looking pattern. It's got two bits to it. It's got a sound pattern and it's also got a pattern of fast inputs. So in a way this is a composition because it's composing together a function with a pattern. And in Tidal, patterns are also functions of time. There is a long strange discussion that I could have around that, but I'll leave that for another video. But yeah, just wanted to make the that's not really a composition because it's not very interesting, but in terms of functions, it is a composition. So there we have. Let's look at a really simple way of composing together patterns. Overlay. So this is just when you get two patterns and you want to compose them. In this case, overlay just sits them on top of each other so that they play at the same time. Oops. So you can hear that there's the low tom, mid tom, high tom pattern, and on top is the clap pattern. So that's a kind of composition in a way. And then stack might be more familiar. We haven't really looked at it in detail, but it's basically doing what overlay does, but lets you work with any number of patterns. So overlay is a bit less useful because it only lets you overlay two patterns. If I wanted to overlay a third one, I'd have to write overlay again and then say something like this. So here there's an overlay that's taking these two and making a new pattern. And then there's another overlay that's taking that new pattern and overlaying it with a third one. So that's a slightly, I mean, it's not that bad actually, but you have to write overlay twice to overlay three patterns together. Whereas with stack, I've got three patterns here. And I can, and it takes care of that overlaying for you. So here we've got a kick and snare pattern on top of those other two that we've already heard. And to make a list of patterns, you have to put a square bracket at the start and end and put a comma in between. So after the last one, it won't work if I put one at the end. It's just like, in between each pattern. But that's just the same as having separate patterns. So what's the point? I mean, I could have just had D1, D2, and D3, which would have been good. Because then you can easily silence them individually. So that has some advantages. But the advantage of a stack, which you'll see some people use a lot. If you watch videos from Mike Kindome, he likes stacking things and then manipulating those stacks together. So here there's that same stack of three, those same three patterns. And I'm applying this manipulation to all of them at once. So that's nice. So that would be more awkward to do with these. So if I had those three running, I mean, you can use this all thing. So I could have done all chunk for hurry two. But then if I'd have added a fourth one, it all's happening to that as well. Which sounds kind of awesome in this case, but that might not be what you want. So to turn off the all function, I'm going to do all ID, which will basically means replace this function with a function that does nothing. So now that the all has stopped. That's quite a useful thing, actually, all. Try it out. But it does, yeah, it just applies to everything. It's really not selective at all. Whereas if you've used this technique of stacking, then it'll only do this function to that stack and nothing else that you might have running in another pattern. You can also, doesn't have to be a function, it can be an effect that you add to a whole stack. So here I've got a squiz switching on and off because it's going between 0 and 2. So that's applying to everything. So when I'm working with this pattern, I can either think, okay, I just want that part squizzed. Or squeeze everything, including the clap and the toms. It's a little hard to hear, but there's a difference just because this kick's kind of really overriding everything. But yeah, and if you put it on the end, it will apply to all three. Okay, so that was overlay and stack, which kind of stacks things up. You could say that it stacks them up vertically. So they all happen at the same time. And then there's equivalence, which is append and cat, which is similar to overlay and stack, but they lay them out over time. So you could say that was vertically. If you imagine time going in this direction and kind of the polyphony happening in this direction, which is probably conventional, then that's how you can think of it. So let's try append. That's just playing this one and then this one, then looping back, going between them. So that's those. That's if you just want to append one to another. If you want to be able to append any number together, then cat is the way forward. So with overlay and stack, people tend to just use stack because it's if you later decide to add one, then you can just drop it in a bit more easily. And the same with cat, people tend to use cat rather than append, or I do at least. Let's see what works for you. So there's three things here. And I'll keep going around. And again, I could have an effect that is just on all the time. Or a function which happens to everything. Pretty nice. Okay, so there's also append and fastappend and fastcat. So let's see. With append, you all have noticed that they stick to the same speed. So in one cycle, it'll pick a cycle from one pattern, and the next cycle, it'll pick one cycle for another pattern. With fastappend and fastcat, it's different. So in the case of fastappend, it'll squash two cycles, one from each, into one cycle. So it'll go twice as fast. With fastcat, it will take all of them, one cycle from all of them, and squash them into one cycle. So that's going three times as fast. And if I add another one, it'll go four times as fast. Nice. Yeah. So that's all fine. But you wouldn't want to make a track like that. You want to have a bit more control over what plays when. And there is a function for that called seqPLoop. So this is actually the same as this, as this one. So the cat just plays one from each cycle. It's a nice cat. And seqPLoop, this one is doing the same. So it's saying this first pattern play from the zeroth cycle until the end of that cycle, until the first one. And then the next cycle from one to two, play this. And from two to three, play this. So this is saying from right at the start until up to the start of the next cycle, play this, and so on. Well, let's listen. So that's just emulating the cat in a way. And this is similar, but I've just played with these numbers a bit. So now this will last for two cycles. When this is halfway through, this will come in and play for two cycles. And then there'll be a gap because between 3 and 5, there's nothing happening. And then there'll be one cycle of this one. There's the gap for two cycles. And so on. So that's quite nice. And you can, doesn't have to be for whole cycles either. You could have this playing for 1.5, and they can overlap, and so you can start building up tracks that way. This will loop, so because this ends on the sixth cycle, at that point it'll loop back to the start. These don't have to be in order, by the way. You could put this here and it would still be exactly the same. It's just this bit at the start which says when it starts and stops. If you wanted, you could name these as well. So instead of putting the pattern here, you could call this Florence and then say let Florence equals that. Run that, and then that should work. And that would mean that you could use it more than once. So you could do, for example, have it start at 3 and last at 5, and put Florence there. And you could even say add some squids or something like that. So here there's one statement for setting that and one statement for running it. If you put in between, you're saying make this true for this particular statement, this block, so it runs together. That's quite nice because it means that you can edit this on the fly. And it'll take instant effect. That's quite nice. There you go. And the other thing is, there's, as well as seqP loop, there's just seqP. Seq stands for sequence, by the way. I should have mentioned that earlier. So this is a version that doesn't actually loop. So if I, let's just make it so it's actually a coherent. So this will last for 4 cycles, and then it'll stop. It won't loop. I've added a queue trigger so that it'll start from 0. Without that, it'll just start from wherever it is, which would be quite far in the future and would just be completely silent because it will have already ended. But you can reset the whole thing to bring it back to 0 like this. Yeah, and you could call that a track. So that's something I have used in the past for making tracks. It can work, but there's one other function which I'll show in the next video called that lets you make patterns of patterns in an interesting way. But I'll leave you with that for now, and see you soon. Bye.